When being too safe kills people. There are many roofs that are too steep. There's never been a better example of how miscalculating risks and trying to be safe actually killed somebody. They decided that this roof was too steep, so this man lost his life. And this man lost an ear. Well, a small chunk of it. Now, we're going to talk about the many instances where scientists are giving exaggerated calculations of risks, which have killed people and will kill far more people in the future. But before that, this guy, do you reckon he looks like the sort of fellow who thinks that the roof was too steep? What do you reckon he said when this person said,
"That building in particular has a sloped roof at its highest point. And so, you know, there's a safety factor that would be considered there, that we wouldn't want to put somebody up on a sloped roof."
You gotta be kidding. Now look, I don't know about him, but many of these bodyguards, they're ex-military, Navy SEALs, Marines. They've been to Iraq and Afghanistan. They're seriously tough hombres. And a roof like that is nothing. And even this one, let's call her a little person. And I know there's been quite a bit of commentary about whether little people should be bodyguards, but I'd wager London to a brick that she would have been quite happy on that roof and would have been very effective there too. What happened here was that we let one small risk dominate the calculation, and it was a terrible mistake. Now, the same problem is happening at the same time in science. Now, I should say that in medical science, your doctor and you are weighing risks all the time. Every medical procedure has a risk, but it's worth taking if there is a benefit or if the risk of not doing it is worse. But there are three huge areas of science where we've made bad mistakes calculating risk. We've failed to put a man, even a little person, on the metaphorical roof. These are nuclear safety, the COVID response, and the threats from climate change. I did a whole video where I showed that the risks of exposure from smallish doses of nuclear radiation are massively overstated, maybe by a factor of as much as 100. We're exposed every day to quite significant doses of radiation coming from the ground and from outer space. My backyard and many others has about a kilogram or two of uranium in the soil in the top 1 meter. So it's not surprising we get quite a bit of exposure. So when Fukushima blew up and spread that extra radioactivity around, it was just adding a little more to the radioactive material that was already there. The actual risk from the extra radiation was very small, but because we calculate the risk from radiation using this completely debunked linear no threshold hypothesis, see this video, the Japanese authorities evacuated large areas around the Fukushima reactor. They said the roof was too steep. Ah, well, you can't be too safe. Well, you can. Displacing people has its own costs. You take some silver-haired old Japanese gentleman who's been living in this area his whole life, and you're moving him away from the home. People get depressed, alcoholic. Don't be surprised when we kill more people than we save. Even for Chernobyl, which was a far worse disaster, the displacement from towns long distant from Chernobyl killed more than it saved. And that doesn't count the abortions that happened in Europe because thousands of pregnant women thought their babies would be deformed from the minuscule, actually irrelevant, amounts of radiation that they received. Those safety limits, where the risk was greatly miscalculated, are the same problem as the man or the little person who was not standing on the roof. The COVID response was the same. There was a single-track way of thinking, save people from COVID no matter what. And yet, the average age where people died of COVID was 85 years. Anything had to be done to stop those 85-year-olds dying, even if it meant almost closing down the health system for other diseases, so cancer diagnoses were missed because screening was delayed, or people could not get appointments to the doctor, or all the COVID response made the hospitals work at about half capacity. And we locked all the young people up who had almost zero risk of dying of COVID. and this has affected many for the rest of their life, just to save some 85-year-olds. Even the climate issue, we are fixated on one risk, that the climate will warm gently by a couple of degrees over the next 100 or so years. And there's been a huge exaggeration of that risk. Now, it is a risk, and it's worse than falling on a slightly sloping roof for sure. But is it really that serious? Deaths from natural disasters are the lowest they've ever been. If this is such a disaster, maybe we need a little bit more of it, actually. If the method of fixing it is destroying the economy and going back to the dark ages in terms of our energy generation systems, especially if governments will reject nuclear power, then that ends up making the cure worse than the disease. We're better off taking the small risk. After all, the extra carbon dioxide in the atmosphere will make our crops grow faster, and let's be frank, most places in the world will be much better a couple of degrees warmer. But for climate, we're ignoring the real climate risk. It's actually a certainty sooner or later. We're worrying about falling on the flat roof of gentle climate change when there's a climate sniper with a head in the crosshairs. And that's the natural, massive and rapid climate change, which we can do nothing to stop, but we can do an awful lot to reduce the impact. When was the last time that a huge volcanic event occurred that blew vast quantities of material into the stratosphere, dimming the sun literally for a year or two, sending massive shocks through the world's weather systems that plunged global temperatures down by a couple of degrees almost immediately? The sun goes dim, the summer fails, crops fails. I'm going to tell you when, but why don't you like and subscribe first? Well, it was 536. Actually, there seemed to have been two events, one in 536 and another a couple of years later. And I think I really need to do a video just on this. It caused massive starvation and disease. And I can tell you that cold weather kills far more people than warm weather. And the loss of sunlight reduces the crop yields, which produces starvation. Now, you're thinking 536 is a long time ago, so why worry? Well, apart from the fact that it could well happen again and easily kills hundreds of millions of people from starvation and wars. Yes, wars, because powerful nations will try to secure a supply of the hugely diminished food production. But these events probably have a return time of around a couple of thousand years. So the average person living on Earth since we migrated out of the African savannah half a million years ago or whatever, is roughly a 1 in 25 chance that they would have lived through one of these mega upheavals. A 1 in 25 chance of massive starvation and war. Now, that eventuality is the equivalent of Trump having his head splattered across the MAGA crowd, and we're worried about the sloped roof of a gently warming climate, where we've got plenty of time to adapt, turn up the air conditioner, provide electricity to everybody so that they can deal with the warmer climate. Crikey, the world has been hotter than now for almost the entire last half a billion years. We can take it. Societies that calculate risk properly are the societies that will prosper. People who can calculate risk properly prosper and have good lives. If you hide in your house because you're worried about being run over by a bus, you're more likely to die of obesity and suicide and from depression because you don't get out enough. Societies and civilizations can make the same mistakes. So, what other examples are there where we miscalculate the risk and likely kill more people than we save? Or when the risk is worth taking because the benefit is what makes life worth living?